Hello everyone, the Vern here from Cinema Recall. Like most other podcasters out there, I used to worry about finding a good hosting site that will allow me to post episodes without worrying about space or my bank account. Well, with Anchor, I no longer have those worries. With Anchor, they have all the great tools that make podcasting very easy, not only on a desktop, but on your smartphone as well. Plus, they will do the work to get your show on multiple podcast players such as Spotify, Stitcher, Podchaser, Apple Podcasts, iHeartRadio, and much, much more. You can earn money with limited listeners too. And the best thing of all, they will do this all for free. That's right, free. So go to Anchor FM today.
This podcast is a proud member of the That Moment In Podcast Network. Check out the network at thatmomentin.com.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to a brand new episode of the Cinema Recall Podcast over on the site thatmomentin.com. I am your host, The Vern, and I am extremely excited to present this new episode because on here, we are going to be talking about probably two of my favorite musicals next to Little Shop of Horrors. We're going to be discussing La La Land and The Umbrellas of Cherbourg. And to help me discuss these two great movies, I brought on two amazing guests. First of all, we have with us from the Across the Universe, the Chips with AdSense podcast, along with their site, returningvideotapes.com. We have with us Sophia Tetzeria. I'm saying that right. Gosh, I'm going to mess this up. Hello, Sophia.
Hi.
Hi. And from howardkasner.wordpress.com, one of the best film critics around, Howard Kasner. Hello, sir.
Well, hello. You know, if it takes forever, I'll wait for you.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, a little...
Yeah, we know how all that turned out.
Yes, a little reference to the Jack to Be feature that we'll be discussing later on. But this is the first time you cats have been on the Cinema Recall podcast, and I'm going to start with you, Howard. Thank you for being on the show with me, buddy. Maybe you can tell the listeners out there about who you are. You know, tell them about what you do on this thing we call the interwebs.
Well, I'm one of those many, many, many aspiring screenwriters that live in L.A., of course. But I make my living doing coverage and script consultation. And that's sort of the focus of my blog, Rantings and Ravings. Much of it is focused on screenwriting and how to improve it and things of that nature. I've published a few books on Amazon, two books of short stories. Now I have to think of their names. The Five Corporations and One True Religion and The Starving Artist and Other Stories. And a book on screenwriting, the second edition of my book called More Rantings and Ravings of a Screenplay Reader.
Very cool. Very cool indeed. And as I mentioned before, you can definitely follow Howard and all of his things through his site, howardkasner.wordpress.com. You can follow him on Twitter at Howard Kasner, C-A-S-N-E-R. Thank you very much for being on the show with me today, Howard.
Sure. Now, thanks for asking.
Well, thank you, sir. So, Sophia, you mm-hmm. are one of the co-hosts of the Across the Universe podcast, as well as your site, Return of Videotapes. Now, I have to ask you this about your site there. Why did you call it Return of Videotapes?
Because of American Psycho. It's one of my favorite scenes, and it's like a recurring line in that movie. You remember that? Yeah, where he keeps saying that he has to return videotapes. And I thought that was fitting because it's like media and it's kind of nostalgic because videotapes are over. So it just kind of fit.
Nice. As I mentioned before, you are one of the co-hosts of the Across the Universe podcast with yes. Nikats and Meta Ray. Now, tell our listeners a little bit more about that show if they're not familiar with it.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Okay. You're one of the co-hosts of the Across the Universe podcast mm-hmm. with Nikat and Meta Ray. Tell the listeners out there a little bit more about that podcast.
Oh, yeah. So we're three chicks from different parts of the globe. So I'm in Portugal, Nikat is in India, and Getter is in Estonia. And I don't know if you know Ryan from the matinee. You probably do. He suggested, I think maybe 5 years ago, that we started an all-female podcast about movies, because at that time with Matt, who was from Germany. And we did, and it's been a few years, and we talk about movies and TV shows, and we upload episodes ideally every other week. That doesn't always happen because busy lives and all of that, but you could always expect us to just talk about latest movies and fun lists and all that stuff. And we're on Spotify and iTunes, Stitcher Radio, all the platforms.
Yes, the recent episode was all on the Academy Awards that just came out. Yeah. Really enjoyed that one.
Sorry, I was going to say what we're doing next. Yeah, we're doing Captain Marvel is recorded, so it should be up in a few days. And we're also going to be looking back at 2018 because we're a little bit behind on that, clearly. But we've done best of non-2018, which is a bit of a tradition where we say our favorite movies that were not from 2018, but we watched last year. And then, of course, the typical best of the year list. So we've got all that lined up, and obviously Infinity War, and yeah.
Very cool.
Very cool. A lot of that's coming up.
Anytime we talk about any movies, it doesn't have to be movies that came out this year. That's fine. So I'm definitely looking forward to the episode because it would give me some recommendations that I would need to watch. So I look forward to that episode. All right. Well, let's do this, folks. I'm going to take a small break right now. We're going to play some ads from some other great podcast shows. And then we'll be back with Sophia to discuss about La La Land.
We'll return after these messages.
Hi, we are the Retro Cinema Podcast.
We were both teenagers in the 1980s. That was a long time ago.
And we only do 80s movies that we loved then and we still love now.
Yep, I'm Gidget Von LaRue.
And I'm Angry Man.
And we are the Retro Cinema Podcast.
Yep, you can find us at theretrocinema.com and just Google us for any listening information you need.
Oh, Connie, you're all muck and muscle.
Oh, Heather, please.
I just heard you play, and I wanted to.
Critics everywhere are wild about La La Land. The best movie of 2016 has now been nominated for 7 Golden Globe Awards, including Best Picture.
It's very, very exciting.
Really?
Winner Best Picture New York Film Critics Circle. It's sheer cinematic bliss and pure movie magic. Don't miss La La Land, rated PG-13, now playing select cities.
And we are back, everyone. Welcome
those
here.
Those are great ads. I thought those were some of the best ads I've ever heard.
They were, weren't they? Amazing stuff right there. Yes, we are back here with the Cinema Recall Podcast over at thatmomentin.com, here with Sophia of the Kids with AdSense, the Across the Universe podcast, to talk about 2016's La La Land, directed by Damien Chazelle and starring Ryan Gosling and Emma Stone. Quick little plot synopsis. I'm not going to go into too much detail about the plot, but they play a pair of dreamers in LA. He wants to run a jazz bar. She wants to be an actress. They meet. They start a relationship. And there are a bunch of wonderful songs throughout this feature. My takeaway of this movie is that I really enjoyed it. I think it was the only movie I saw since Pulp Fiction that I saw the most times in theaters. Like, I saw Pulp Fiction like 4 times in theaters. This was almost three times in theaters, but I enjoyed it heavily. Sophia, let me get into your thoughts about the overall movie before we talk about your favorite moment, all right? So what are your thoughts on La La Land?
It's a movie that I absolutely love. I watched it. I didn't watch it multiple times in theaters, but I did watch it once back then in 2016. And I'm a huge fan of old Hollywood and jazz. And I'll get more into that when I speak about my favorite moments. But this movie just spoke a lot to me on that sense of loving movies and loving romance movies. I thought it was just magical. The way it was shot, it was filled with little nods to old Hollywood and all of that. So it was just a movie that makes you love film, you know. That was my takeaway, really. And immensely fun. Obviously, I love musicals, so even better. And rewatching it has been a blast because I love it even more today, I think.
And that's a great thing you said, too, about it referencing old Hollywood, because I saw references to Singing in the Rain and, you know, the Brothers of Cherbourg, which me and Howard will talk about later on. It's got this great use of color and the costumes and the scene. And usually musicals can kind of be hit or miss for me. Sometimes when I watch a musical, the songs are just so bad that it just takes me out of the movie completely. But from the opening number of Another Day of Sun, it just really got me hooked into this. And if you miss this one in theaters, I feel kind of bad for you a little bit. I'm not saying you can't enjoy it at home, but it has a much more better feeling when you watch it in theaters. So yeah, I'm glad you love this film as much as I do, Sophia. So I'm going to start with you then and talking about your favorite moments from this movie.
Yes. Okay. Favorite. It's a bit hard because I kind of have two moments, but they're similar in a way, but very different. Can I do that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. And this is just to clarify, is this spoiler free?
Yes. Okay. Yes. There's going to be some spoilers for both of these movies. I feel like both of these movies have a very similar structure in a way, but
yeah, I'll give a warning just in case no one has seen it and really wants to keep it, because it's kind of unavoidable for the other moment. Okay.
Every episode we do of the movies we covered, it's going to be spoiled. All right. So just let you know, from a long time listeners, shit's going to get spoiled. All right.
Okay. So the first moment that I really love about this film is the sequence when she's at the restaurant with her boyfriend or something, and she hears their song play on the speakers, and she runs to him.
I know what you're talking about. Yes, go on.
Yeah, you know. Okay. And she runs to him, and she goes to the movie theater where they were supposed to be watching Rebel Without a Cause. And then they go in to kiss, but the real burns. And then they go to the observatory of the film, and they have the whole sequence of dancing. So it's kind of, that's like my whole favorite moment. It's the whole sequence. I can't cut it. Sorry.
That's good right there too. It's definitely a musical sequence, but there's no scene involved with it.
There isn't. And like you said, the songs are great. But I love this moment, particularly from the moment she gets up to when they finish dancing at the, I don't know if it's called an observatory. Sorry. It's like, I don't know if you say English.
It's the, it's an observatory.
It's a park. Yeah. Okay.
The Griffith Park Observatory. Yeah.
Okay, exactly. Because as I was saying about old Hollywood and romance and everything, romance movies, I mean, I felt like this whole sequence kind of embodied that genre that is a bit dead these days, you know, like rom-coms and big romance films just aren't made like this part of the film anymore. I feel like today they are very grounded in reality. You know, it's very much about the grittiness of real life, which just goes there after. But in this scene, it just kind of embodies everything that I love about Hollywood and romance films. And it's just a scene that more than about Sebastian and Mia, because I didn't feel like it was truly about them. It was more about the dream of everything that they represent in that moment. For me, it's just a sequence that fills me with joy every time I see it. And I love how they play with little moments, like when the reel burns up and Ryan Gosling is just frustrated because they were about to kiss. They just reel with really sweet moments. And when they take off, like they start floating, that's the moment I go like, that's Hollywood, you know, that's, you can do that. I feel like today maybe, I don't know why it is, maybe we're just a little saturated from coming in from those decades, and then maybe in the 90s where there were a lot of romantic comedies all around. Maybe we're saturated, or maybe we're just not willing to let go for 2 hours, you know, in a dark theater of all those real life things. I don't think that's it, but that moment just really, I love it more than everything when they float, because that's what makes me feel like that is movies. That is why I watch movies, you know?
No, I totally agree with that sequence right there. And you were saying that it pays homage to old classic Hollywood. What yes. does it with that sequence with silent movies? And yeah. that sequence, yeah. it reminds me of a moment in, I think it was Modern Times, with Charlie mm-hmm. Chaplin just roller skating around everywhere. I just got really giddy during that sequence. And when the music swells up and they both float up, yeah, you're definitely right. It's a great, wonderful fantasy sequence. I like the way that the musical score kind of accompanies their yeah. moments. Every time they do a little turn, the music matches with it. There's a moment where he's trying to adjust something with the planetarium, whatever that big device is, in the middle of it. And you hear mm-hmm. like little flutes happen when she like brushes his hands away. Yeah, it's a really just an endearing moment of the feature, and it shows just through music and body language and facial expressions of these two characters fall in love. And you don't need to do that with any big dialogue sequence. It can just be a little look mm-hmm. or a move or a turn that they play off each other that I feel is really good and really great scene. I really do love that scene a lot. I really thought you were going to be talking about like one of the songs. So for mine, I was kind of going through all of the different songs. Like, shit, she might choose this one. She might choose this. So I had like a list of like different musical moments. That's a great moment there. I love that sequence very much. For me, my favorite moment of this movie is with the song someone in the crowd.
You got the invitation, you got the right address. You need some medication, the answer's always yes. A little chance encounter could be the one you've waited for. Just squeeze a bit more. Tonight we're on a mission, tonight's the casting call. If this is the real audition,
oh God, help us all.
You make the right impression, then everybody knows your name.
That is probably yeah. my favorite portion of that feature, just the way that it begins. It starts mm-hmm. off with, I'm trying to read it out, Emma Stone's character, I think her name is like Mia.
Yes, yes.
They're basically in this in the movie. Her friends want to take her out to this big party,
mm-hmm.
and she doesn't really want to quite go there.
Did they persuade her? Yeah.
Yeah, they're trying to persuade her throughout the song. I think the colors are just absolutely amazing and just bright. I like the fact too that during that sequence, it sort of changes. You know, it goes from, I guess, from blues to reds,
mm-hmm.
to other
features. Yeah, it's incredibly fun moment and awesome song. Really great lyrics, just so funny. And yeah, I love it too. I'm just mesmerized by the girls, their dresses, everything. And that's actually something interesting in both scenes, is that in both our scenes, and then throughout the movie, I guess. But the dancing, unlike maybe those classic films, it's not too professional. In fact, it's not professional at all when it's particularly Emma Stone and Ryan Gosling dancing. Do you notice that? They're very natural, you know? Yeah, because they're not professional dancers. So I find that endearing. And in this scene as well, it just gives... It's kind of like how they said, you know, that jazz is out of style and you got to reinvent it. I feel like this movie attempts in one kind of to pay homage and kind of reinvent again the genre a bit. And that is a part of it because it's not too strict, you know,
no.
The dancing and the singing. It's not too contrived in that very polished kind of musical type.
Everyone in the sequence, including the part when Emma Stone and the other ladies go out into the street and they mm-hmm. have that choreographed dance number, it all feels very natural. And this is the moment that I think is why it won for Best Cinematography at the Oscars. Because just the way how the colors change gradually throughout this. Because it goes from a green to red,
the pink,
to yellow, to the party that's all in red and black.
Mm-hmm.
And then later on when Emma Stone leaves the bathroom, it goes to white and blue. And her blue dress throughout this is really good. It has a great contraction or contrast throughout this. And I love the moment when the diver jumps off and he lands in the pool and the camera starts spinning around everywhere because mm-hmm. it sort of represents being kind of drunk and being drunk at a party. Just spinning around, having a good time. Everyone's laughing, enjoying themselves right there. Just really enjoy that. From a technical aspect, this movie has just some really amazing camera moments. I think the opening sequence of Another Day of Sun, how it's meant to look like all it's all done in one shot.
Yeah.
Is also an amazing sequence. But I go to Someone in the Crowd as my favorite moments of cinematography just because of the way the colors are all balanced with each other and the movement of the camera. Especially,
exactly.
Yeah.
The movements, I think it's the choreographies are great, but the movement of the camera in conjunction with dancing and everything, I feel like it's just amazing in this film.
Yeah. All right, well, that's pretty much all. My other favorite moment, and this is the moment that always makes me cry every time I watch this movie.
Yeah.
And I'm strong myself to admit this, but the moment that always brings a tear to my eye every time I watch it is the audition scene with Emma Stone. I cannot watch that sequence without shedding a little tear there.
The big audition?
Yeah, when she goes and sings about her aunts and everything. Yes, that's the moment that always makes me cry. Like, just her performance. And here's the cool thing, too. Emma Stone actually shot that sequence, like, 9 times. And she said it live 9 times. But director Damien Chazelle just used the second take of it. And that's the take that's in the movie.
I think that too, but for me, the crying bit, I mean, that I cry in that moment because it's about, you know, the dreams, and it's kind of, I kind of project myself onto her, you understand? Okay. And so I feel her pain and the fictional pain of the character that she's talking about, but it's kind of like the dreams that we have and the life that we want and when we can't get it. And this movie speaks a lot about that too, to creatives or to anyone who, you know, aspires to something that is maybe a bit of a long shot. But then for me, the real bawling moment is, and that was kind of the spoiler thing, it's the final sequence, the entire sequence where she sees what her life would have been with him if life were perfect, you know. That just wrecks me completely.
I can understand that. But at the very last moment when they meet each other, I'm filled with so much joy and happiness.
I can't. It's even sadder. They try to smile, but they're just so heartbroken. I feel it all over again.
There's a heartbroken moment there. When I watch that, I don't feel heartbroken because they kind of see each other. They know that they both achieved their dreams, and they're both happy for each other. They know they can never be together, but they're still both very happy for each other. So yes, it's bittersweet, but it's something that feels complete, and they are both can move on, and they're both happy people because of it.
I hope so. I don't know. I feel some heartbreak in those looks, but yeah.
Maybe a little heartbreak here and there.
Yeah.
it reminds me of past relationships, you know, and sometimes if I just see them where they are now and be like, hey, all right, you're doing good for each other. You're doing good for yourself. We didn't work out. That's fine, but you're happier now.
Yeah. No. It's true. They achieved their goals.
Yeah.
Just not together, which is unfortunate. But yes. But that's like something, that's what I meant about kind of reimagining the genre and making it a bit more modern in the second half, kind of like from the moment he goes with the band on tour, where it kind of falls down and things change. I think that makes it better for a modern audience than if it were a perfect ending where they go back, get back together, you know?
Yeah.
That's what sets it apart for today. That's the way I love it even more.
Exactly. I think that a lot of audience would have, even though audience want to have the happy ending, it would seem too smolchy and people would complain that, oh, it's just another smolchy Hollywood ending movies that we've all seen before. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you, Sophia, to talk about La La Land with me today, about your favorite moments. Next up, I'm going to have Howard on to discuss about our favorite movies, our favorite moments from the Imposter Shortboard. But I got to take one small break to pay, to play, not pay. No ads are paying me anything, all right? I'm going to play some ads from other great podcast shows. And podcasters, if you want to pay me to play your ads, I will be like massaging your back and everything, all right? I will just be groping you in ways you don't want to be groped.
After these messages, we'll be right back.
Hi, everyone. This is Tim Costa.
I'm Hermano da Silva.
And this is Walter Vinci.
And together, we are the First Time Watchers Podcast.
Each week, we choose a movie to review that none of us has seen.
Watch it together.
And then discuss.
These movies could be new.
Or old.
Or on our list of shame.
You can find us on iTunes by searching for the First Time Watchers Podcast.
As well as on Stitcher.
And we love interacting with our listeners, so if you have any suggestions, send us a tweet.
An email.
Or post to our Facebook page.
We'd love to hear from you.
That's right. I mean, it's all about interaction.
And talk about what we love. Movies.
And you don't have to worry about us going on and on about this and that and the other. And
let's talk about this minutiae.
Shut up.
God damn it, shut up.
I think that's enough, Walter.
Oh my God, go by during the credits.
This podcast is a proud member of the Lamb Podcasting Network. Find the network at largeassmovieblogs.com.
Mon amour, oh mon amour.
Geneviève, ma petite Geneviève.
Guy, je t'aime.
A boy and a girl are in love. She becomes pregnant. He goes off to war. They end up married to other people. This story is pure kitchen sink realism, suitable maybe for a Raymond Carver story or a Bruce Springsteen song. But nonetheless, it is the plot of the musical The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, directed by Jacques Demy, surely one of the most romantic films ever made.
Je ne reviendrai pas d'ici longtemps.
And we are back here with the episode of Cinema Recall. Now to talk with Howard Kasner, the great Howard Kasner, to discuss the movie The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, Jacques Demy's fully musical feature, came out in 1964, stars Catherine Deneuve, and I think it was like Pino, I can't remember his name right now.
Castellanova, I think.
Pino Castellanova, yes.
Castellanova, I don't know.
Yeah, you have to do it right there.
It's Italian. That's all I know.
Music by Michel Legrand, or it could be Michael Legrand. I will say that this is a movie that is fully sung. Like, every word of dialogue is sung. I love this movie a lot, but I will admit it took me a few years to fully love this movie. Let's get to your thoughts on The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, Howard.
Well, first of all, I think we should say that it's very appropriate in many ways that we're talking about this now, because Demy's wife, Agnès Varda, who some people consider to be the real founder of the French New Wave, died just a few days ago.
Yes, good point there.
Yeah. I love this movie. I've seen it about four times over the years. I loved it from when I first saw it. I'd never quite seen a movie or musical like it. It is one of my top five favorite musicals. I love pretty much everything about it, the music, the color, the actors, and the story, which I didn't expect to end the way it did the first time I saw it. So I was a little surprised at that. But I think it is one of the greatest musicals ever made.
That, too. I also think it's one of the best love stories ever made.
Yes.
And
I mean, we always say that things are always going to be the same and things will never change, and that the first person you fall in love with will be the last person you fall in love with. But that's just not how the way the world works.
Oh, yeah. I definitely remember my first relationship, and I thought it was just going to be just me and her forever and ever. And it just never was that way at all. And it wasn't a tragic breakup, you know, if you looked at it, but I could definitely turn our relationship into a movie just like this, all right, you know, and that situation, she met another guy, and they fell in love, and got married, and everything, and it was, and they're both fine, we're still all friends and everything, but, yeah, now, this movie, The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, I first saw this movie back when I was 13, 14 years old.
So how long ago was that? 10 years?
Yeah, 10 years. Yeah, no. well, no, that's probably 20 years right now. But anyways, when I first saw this movie, it was on VHS, and I just remember it just came out with this Bradley newly restored edition, and I saw that it won all of these awards, like the Cannes Film Festival. And I was like, oh, cool! Pulp Fiction won the Cannes Film Festival award, so I'm going to like this movie just the same. As that was my mindset when I first watched this movie. So I popped it in, and I did not mind musicals because I was a big fan of Little Shop of Horrors, and I've seen My Fair Lady. But when I found out that it was singing throughout the whole entire thing, I was a little bit put off by that. So much that in my 13-year-old mind, I just could not finish watching it. I was like, nope. Not for me, and it wasn't until I was in my probably late 20s that my dad was giving away a whole bunch of VHS tapes, and I saw that the Embossed Shirtboard was in there, so I decided to give it another watch, and I stuck with it to the end, and ended up loving it a lot, mainly because of the way the story is constructed. It is a very simple story, and it's one of the stories that... Oh, go ahead.
No, I was agreeing. It's a very simple story that is one of the things about it.
And it's one of those movies that doesn't work well on paper. It's one of those movies you have to see visually to really fully understand and love this movie. And it's one of those movies that you really have to just go into it blindly, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. If you don't like musicals or anything like that, I can't really sell you on this movie. But it does have some wonderful cinematography. Just like La La Land we mentioned earlier, I mean, the way the colors are balanced in this are just really good. It's eye candy. And I love it immensely. But I do want to get into your favorite moments of The Embossed Shirtboard, Howard. So don't hold back, buddy. What is your favorite moment of this movie?
Well, it's almost an insult to ask, because what other scene could be the favorite moment from this movie except for the farewell at the train station?
Mais je ne pourrai jamais vivre sans toi. Je ne pourrai pas, ne parle pas, j'en mourrai. Je te cacherai et je te garderai. Mais mon amour ne me quitte pas.
Song, the music used there became the song If It Takes Forever, I Will Wait For You. Which, of course, that's not what they sing. They sing just normal dialogue, but it became this huge hit. And
you know what? I heard that song used in another movie. I think it was Band of Outsiders.
That's quite possible. Michelle Legrand, who did the music for this, also did the music for Band of Outsiders. Or actually, probably what happened is they just used this part of it for Band of Outsiders, and he gets credit for it.
Yeah,
it was a huge Tony Bennett hit, and other people also sang it. And I just have to hear it, and I start tearing up because I'm thinking of the scene where they're parting at the train station. And I think it is the greatest parting at a train station in film history, even above Since You Went Away and A Brief Encounter. It just always brings tears to my eyes.
Is it better than when Miss Piggy leaves the train in Muppets Take Manhattan?
Well, I suppose I really can't say I haven't seen The Muppets Take Manhattan.
That moment brings a tear to my eye every time I see it, all right? Pig and Frog's been separated. But no, go on here. I think, the sequence here, even when they're at the restaurant and he's holding her and she's sobbing and crying, I think it's great. Go ahead, continue on.
This probably even had more resonance for the French audience, because he's going off to the Afghanistan war. And it's not exactly our Vietnam, but it's sort of like people look back on that and say, you know, why did we ever have this war in France? I think the other is the very ending. It is the ending where you find out what happened to them. And it's all against the back, a huge background of the gas company Esso, which you will see in a huge number of French films. I mean, talk about product placement. It's at the beginning here, it's at the end here. So I always like the way the Esso is very, very clear. But the ending, the ending is very, it's just very moving, because you don't really expect at that time a musical to really end like that. And the little boy is played by Michelle Legrand's son, and the little girl is played by the Agnes Varda's daughter, who Jacques Demy adopted when they got married. And it's just so, it's sort of bittersweet because both of them do have lives. It's not like their lives ended tragically. They both went on with their lives and they both have some sort of satisfaction, but it's still very, very bittersweet.
Very much so. The daughter that's in the car, I forget her name, but she was one of the main influences to get the film restored. She's the one that, you know, got the film to be restored to look as good as it does now in my beautiful Blu-ray copy of the movie, which I'm so happy that I have to own right now, because the VHS copy that I had was falling apart, so I'm glad I got this new movie right now. And you, sir, just took my favorite moment of this movie. One of my favorite moments was the very end sequence. I like it because the full rest of the movie is full of, like, colors. Like, the very beginning of the movie, it's very bright and colorful, and I've noticed this the last time I watched it, but the color slowly starts to fade away from the movie, very gradually, and it goes from bright and colorful to at the very last sequence when it's just snow, and it's snow all around, and I like the moments when they are seeing each other again, and they have the look of recognition, and they're remembering moments from their past. And I like the fact, too, that Jatami does not add in a montage of them from the past. Because most of the movies would have done that. They would have shown sequences of them, like, being in love and being together, and then trying to juxtapose that with this moment here. And I'm really glad that it avoided that sequence. And you're right. It's both characters are happier, you know, with their lives now. It's a little bittersweet. I do think that Catherine Deneuve, who plays Genevieve, her new boyfriend, Roland Castel, which I can't remember. I think it's the guy's name. Roland.
I think it's Mark Michel.
Yeah, that's the actor, Mark Michel Roland, who plays Roland Castard. When you first see this movie, you think he's going to be very slimy and out to get their fortune or whatever, their money, but it's not that way at all. And he has a great moment when he's talking to the mom about his love for her daughter. And I really kind of enjoyed that moment with both of them. I guess the weird thing too is that at the time, the mother, played by Anne Vernon, she was not much older than Catherine Deneuve when they shot this.
That's really, things like that are really funny. Like if you see North by Northwest and Cary Grant, Cary Grant's mother is only a few years older than Cary Grant, things like that. Yeah, it's kind of. It's kind of odd, but yeah, that happens all the time. Mm-hmm. What can you do? But Mark Michel actually played this character earlier in a Jacques Demy film called Lola, and I think also plays it again in another movie at some time. I can't remember what. But yeah, he's in the movie Lola made a few years before.
Well, the only other Jacques Demy film that I've seen was The Young Girls of Rochefort.
Yeah.
Also starring Catherine Deneuve. Very different movie. I mean, that was a comical farce about two sisters trying to find love in France. It is not tragic at all, and it's a very much a standard structure of a musical. Gene Kelly plays a role in this. It's weird to listen to him speak French.
Yes. Was it his voice or was he dubbed? I don't really remember.
I think it might have been dubbed. It does not sound like Gene Kelly's voice.
And he probably was. That can also be fun, too. If you ever hear Burt Lancaster dubbed in Italy, he sounds much better dubbed.
Really?
I mean, they would have the same person would always dub the same actor in France and Italy. They had people that were known, actually, for dubbing them. They knew, the people would know who the dubber was in these films. And they sometimes became celebrities in their own right.
Now, I mentioned before that this movie, like I said before, won the Palme d'Or at the 64 Cannes Film Festival. And it was a mildly big hit in the U.S. I believe it was nominated for, I think it was nominated for the Oscars.
For five
Oscars, yeah. And which is kind of odd, because today, if you were to bring out a movie that is all seinen, and even in another language, I don't think it would go over so well.
Well, there is one movie that did, and that's Les Miserables, which is all sad. But of course, that's based on a huge Broadway hit. But I think one of the reasons, sometimes I think one of the reasons why it did so well, like at the Palme, is, yeah, you haven't really seen anything like it. It's technically an opera, but it's not really an opera. It's a musical, and I think it just really, nobody expected it.
Good point there. Yeah, definitely. You know, it's kind of hard on a podcast to talk about how beautiful this movie is.
Gorgeous. It's gorgeous.
It's gorgeous cinematography. The scene in it is all great.
There's nothing needs painted. Everything looks like it's been recently painted.
Yeah.
Painted very well with very bright colors. And things like that. It is a very beautiful. And I guess the shop still exists. If you go to Cherbourg, you can actually go by the shop. There's a little sign there and everything. But yes, the gorgeous cinematography where everything just pops. You know, Crayola crayon, the brightness.
And this was like kind of coming out. You mentioned Agnès Varda was being kind of like the pioneer of the French New Wave, and this is coming out during those times, but this is very different from movies like Breathless, and like I mentioned before, the Band of Outsiders.
I always thought it was very, very interesting or very odd that Varda and Demy made totally different kinds of movies. Each had their own way of making movies, and Demy was much more of a romantic approach. I mean, he was during the New Wave. I've never really hear him mentioned as being exactly part of the New Wave. But Agnès Varda, who made films before Truffaut, some people now consider her the beginning of the New Wave. And they both just kept making movies. They just kept making movies.
Yeah.
Totally different from each other.
No. Really cool. Like I said before, Howard said before, nominated for 5 Oscars, including Best Foreign Language Film, Best Screenplay, Best Song, Best Score. Very cool. It's within two, I guess, Back to the Past too, and I'm just noticing this right now, that there was a category for Best Adaptation of a Music Score. So there was, like, Best Score, Best Song, and then Best Adaptation Score.
Best Adaptation Score tended to be for musicals, I think, most of the time. Because they were adapted from stage plays. But I'm not totally sure. But then, you know, there stopped being as many musicals, and so they finally dropped that category.
All right. That's all I know.
Because theoretically, 2001.
Go ahead, sorry.
No, I said because theoretically 2001, I suppose, would fall into that category if all the music was probably original, but I bet they used pre-recorded music for that.
Possibly. I don't have any more thoughts about the Umbrellas of Cherbourg that we have not both mentioned already. I think it's a wonderful movie. I even like the sequence when you both meet Genevieve and what's the name of your guy? Guy. When they both meet each other and they're singing about, you know, the names of their children. And he's talking about gasoline and how it's a perfume just like any other. Yeah, very sweet moments. Nothing else I can say about this movie. If you watched it before, like I was when I was a dumb young kid and didn't get into the movie, give it a few years, watch it again, and you will end up being in love with it as much as I am now. I own the movie. I'm glad I do. I watch it at least once every year. Yeah, it's really great. That's going to kind of wrap up, I think, our discussion about that movie. Closing thoughts here, and I'll start with you, Sophia. Anything coming up next on your site or on the podcast?
On the podcast, as I mentioned before, we're having Captain Marvel, and we're going to have, of course, Infinity War Endgame. And on the website, you can expect that, of course, and also just continuing with the Blind Spot series and whatever I feel like writing about.
Very good. And you can find out everything that Sophia writes about on the site, returninvideotapes.com, and on Twitter, you are MSophia
Teixeira. Yeah.
Teixeira. I gotta spell this out for listeners, okay? So M Sophia, it sounds, and then T-E-I-S-E-I-R-A.
Or just, you know, if you search returning videotapes, it probably comes up, because okay. It's in the name as well.
Okay, good. Okay, because, yeah, tape the returning videotapes. Very lovely to have you on here, Sophia. I really appreciate that. Howard, good sir, any upcoming episodes on the Lambcast you're going to be on, or...
I was just the most recent one I was on was for Silverado, which was the movie of the month. I don't think I'm up for any. The last my last posting on my blog was an essay on the most important films ever made, not the greatest films, but the most important films ever made.
Oh, very cool. Awesome. Check that out. Howard, of course, can be found on the site howardcastner.wordpress.com, and you have the most easiest name to find on Twitter. Just got David Howard Kastner.
Yeah, there are only a few other Howard Kastners in the United States, as it is.
Have you met them yet?
No, and some of them are dead. It's always weird when I Google meet myself, and there's an obituary for a Howard Kastner. I'm going, wait, do they know something I don't know? Someone I never met.
Gosh. All right, so next week on Cinema Recall, I will be looking back at the movie that sort of revolutionized the whole movie musical and made it hip again for a younger audience. I'm going to be looking back at 2001's Moulin Rouge with Ewan McGregor and Nicole Kidman, and I'll be asking if that movie still holds up or not. So check that out next week. As always, you can follow all our podcasts on Anchor. Just type in the words That Moment In Presents. We're available on, I want to say, Google Podcasts and Apple Podcasts and Spotify and even some new ones like Breaker and Radiocast. Yeah, just type the words in That Moment In Presents and we're on there. We're part of thatmomentin.com. But yeah, definitely check that out. We're on Twitter at @cinema_recall. Facebook, we're on Cinema Recall. Just search there. Big thanks to our guests for being on this episode. Really appreciate that, guys and gals. But that's going to wrap up with it right now. Thank you all for listening. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye.